Jesus is not an idea. He's not a philosophy. Jesus is a historical figure who lived in time and space and history. He was crucified. He was whipped. He was whipped until his skin had almost totally been ripped off. Then bleeding and broken, lacerated, he was nailed to a cross. And they left him there to slowly asphyxiate, to die. Be honest with me. Deep down in your heart, do you actually believe in the incarnation? Are you a Christian? Do you realize that 11 of the 12 apostles plus Paul were repeatedly arrested, imprisoned, beaten, and finally executed because they followed Jesus and not the political leaders of the day? Are you willing to participate and support a system that murders babies, that loves and approves the homosexual lifestyle, that operates as a criminal enterprise? Are you proud of a nation that removes God from their classrooms, from their courthouses, from their hearts? Or do you choose Jesus like the martyrs of the past, 2,000 years, as by their example they converted souls and built the church? The church has won converts not by being weak and compromising with the wicked culture of the day, or by providing insipid prosperity sermons to a brain-dead people who love the entertainment of the world while they're served coffee and donuts. That's not the church of history. The church has always grown by shedding its blood while standing strong in Jesus Christ as their Lord and walking in obedience to his commands. The church grew in past years day by day, while it stood against the world. But today, the church has lost all of its power and influence. It's become Madison Avenue. It's become a business. It's become a house of entertainment. It's become a social club. The church is snuggled cozily in bed with the world, with the government, with the culture. And every wicked thing has flooded in to destroy the church. The love of money, the love of ease and comfort, the love of personal ambition and pride, worldly music, sexual uncleanness. The dance of the world has become the dance of the church. Now, you can choose to bow to the world, to compromise with sin. You can choose to believe that you're saved in the midst of your sin with some sweet lying doctrine about eternal security. You can keep your money and your car. You can keep all of your stuff. You can keep your comfortable American lifestyle and your happy sinful church. That's your choice. I choose Jesus. I choose freedom. Now, what is freedom? Freedom is to be alive in Christ Jesus. Freedom is not keeping your money and your stuff. Freedom is not going wherever, whenever you want to go. Freedom is not earthly liberty. Freedom is following Jesus Christ. Freedom is knowing and living the gospel of righteousness and walking in holiness on this narrow path toward what John Bunyan called the celestial city. Do you get it? Almost everything we experience today that we call church is milquetoast. It's been feminized. It's been dumbed down. It's turned into a pleasing culture where everybody wants to keep everybody happy. I don't want to keep anybody happy. I want to keep you holy. I want to send you toward the cross where you'll be crucified with Christ, where you will separate yourself from the wickedness of the world, and by choice, you will stand up against it and not support it. Now, right now, we've been offered a very interesting choice between the Democrats, who are going to boo and hiss at God, or the Republicans, who are going to bow at Baal's idol. It's all about prosperity and the individual right to go his own way. And they're right. You have the right to go your own way. But there will be a judgment day. There is a heaven to win and a hell to miss. And I want to say very bluntly to you today, the Democrats and the Republicans are simply two wings of the same vulture. We are seeing Babylon emerge as America. We are seeing a nation that has created its own wealth by the printing press, by factional reserve banking. We are seeing a whole Western world now on the verge of total collapse and the emergence of the one world government. We're watching as everything the scripture describes for the end days is taking place before our eyes. The Gog-Magog war is being prepared even as you're listening to this broadcast. Now you can wake up and you can stop compromising with the world and stop playing footsie with the devil. You can stop going to your wonderful, happy, nice coffee and donuts church where nobody ever says anything that would displease you, and give up your religion and follow Jesus. Or you can go back and go to sleep, turn Pastor Ray off, and forget that you heard this. This is not about you and me. This is about Jesus. And the question is, will you be a pilgrim in this earth, hating everything of the world, the devil, and the flesh? Will you be a pilgrim for Jesus Christ, taking that straight and narrow road that the world will look at and say you're a fool because you are giving up what we treasure? Oh, but we're not. We're not fools. Because we're playing for eternity, not here. So if I'm put in prison for proclaiming this word, and some of you have said to me, Pastor, I'm concerned when you begin to say things like this because somebody's listening. Well, yes, thank you. Make them listen. I don't care if they put me in prison or if they in some way take my things or take my life. I'm not here for now. I'm here for eternity. Is that true also in your life? Have you been crucified with Christ? Are you a radical, sold-out soldier of the cross of Jesus Christ? If you're not, you're not a Christian. Oh, you may have the words Christian on the outside, but you've just been spray-painted with Christianity. You're still a pagan at heart. You still love the world and the things of the world. When will you make a decision to wake up and see what's happening with the American economy, with the Western world, and know that it's being engineered by deliberate design for the collapse of America? They cannot raise up the one world government as long as America has its freedom and as long as America is exercising its rights under the Constitution. So they have to destroy the Constitution. They have to destroy the wealth of America. They have to enslave Americans so that we can be reduced to simply one of the many nations of the world who will be grouped together in a group of 10 rulers who will rule over the world under the power of one ruler who will be Antichrist. And yes, the day is coming when they will demand that we be a cashless society and you have to have the mark. Don't you see? This is all developing right before our eyes. You read it in the Washington Post. You read it in all of the publications that are out today. There is a growing hatred for Israel. We know that was going to happen from the Word of God. There will be an attempt to destroy Israel, and God will step in and deliver them by His power. I'm not interested in seeing any Jewish person die. They are God's chosen people. Now, they've been broken off, but I'm standing by faith that they'll be grafted into Jesus once more. For in them was the repository of the law, the glory of God, the glory of Jesus. Jesus was born as a Jewish man. My heart is totally given to praying for the peace of Jerusalem, even as I see the Gog-Magog war shaping for the utter destruction of God's people. I feel very privileged. I feel very honored as a Gentile to have been grafted in to the vine. John the 15th chapter. Romans the 11th chapter. I'm honored that I could be grafted in to the vine. Have you been grafted in? Are you bearing fruit? Are you sold out for Jesus? Are you happy with a God idea, a Jesus philosophy that allows you to include all of the things of the world and walk and look and act like the world, but still claim that you're a Christian? Are you ready for some radical faith, the faith of our fathers? Are you ready to take a stand and not be dumb and stupid? Are you willing to open your eyes and see what's happening and wake up, not to fight against any government, but to fight for Jesus Christ, not with weapons of mass destruction, not with a sword or a spear or a knife or a gun, but with spiritual weapons, with love, with compassion, with self-sacrifice, with a total focus on serving and honoring and worshiping Jesus? Not a denomination, not a church organization, but Jesus. I find people coming to the National Prayer Chapel who are utterly disillusioned with denominationalism, who are utterly disillusioned by the church's serving out these insipid, lukewarm sermons that tickle and feel good but have no righteousness and no conviction of sin. People come to the National Prayer Chapel and they say, "Pastor, I've been fed today the Word of God. I was so hungry for Jesus." Well, it's time. I've been sharing with you this book by Rees Howells, The Story of Rees Howells, written by Norman Grubb. Rees Howells was a radical, sold-out Christian. His walk is very unlike anything most would experience today, but his walk is what we must have if we are going to serve Jesus. My name is Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel, and I welcome you to this broadcast of Pilgrim's Progress. Our phone number in studio, 877-534-0780. That number again, 877-534-0780. Don't call and argue with me. I'm not in a place to argue with you. I'm sold out for Jesus. I'm not into argument. But I am very much into repentance of sin, confession of wickedness, and testimonies of victory, and walking clean before God with no known sin in your life. I praise God this morning. I'm walking clean before Him, washed by the blood without sin. Oh, still immature, still with infirmities, but no rebellion against the Most High God. And I've come to speak to you about Jesus. I pray your heart is encouraged today to lay aside the Laodicea, weak, wimpy kind of religion that has taken over the American church, that you'll rise up and be willing to be crucified for Christ, that you'll rise up in your spirit and not be dumbed down by the luxurious American lifestyle that has been poured out for all of us. Even the poorest among us are exceedingly wealthy compared to most in the world. So I'm going to begin reading for you today the 10th chapter in the book Rees Howell's Intercessor. Part of this will be review from when I was here a week and a half ago. But I need to review it all because you need to get the point that's being made. So chapter 10, page number 69. There was to be a special meeting one night in the village. A friend of Rees Howell's was giving the sermon. The two had arranged to walk over to the village together, but when it was time to start, the special speaker sent word that he could not come. On hearing this, Rees was greatly upset. He realized why. He had not been carrying a burden for the meeting that day as he usually did. He'd been depending more on his friend than on the Holy Spirit. He soon found also that the presence of God, which usually accompanied him on the night journey to the village, was withdrawn and the Spirit of God was grieved. He walked about halfway with a heavy heart until he could bear it no longer. "Please forgive me," he said to the Lord. "I promise that it will never happen again. If you will only come and give victory to this meeting, then I vow, like Japheth, that on my return tonight, I will give you whatever you ask." There was a great blessing in the meeting, and walking home, as he came to the place of his vow, he asked the Lord what he would have of him. The answer was unexpected. "After tonight," the Lord said, "I want you to be a steward and not an owner. Will you give up all claim on your money to me?" Rees did not understand this. Was not his money already the Lord's? The Lord then showed him his position. He had previously faced the fact that he could not ask God to meet a need if he could supply it himself. So all his money had actually been spent in the Lord's work. But it was still his money, and he had the joy of giving it and the right of giving it or to withhold it. "In the future," the Lord said, "you will not have the right to even give without my permission, and not a penny of my money will be spent except on essentials." Explaining what he meant by this, the Lord asked him, "If you had a family of children who were without food or clothing, would you spend a penny on a daily paper or on any non-essential?" "No. Well, the world is my parish, and while there is one person needing the necessities of life, you will not spend a penny on anything else." He faced honestly what it would mean to lose that joy of giving and the bondage he would be in for the rest of his life. But he'd come before God to pay his vow. So turning from the path, he knelt on the grass at the side of the road. And as there was no one else present, he called on the stars and the cloud of witnesses to record that from that night on, he was only a channel. As he walked on, the enemy whispered, "Do you know what you have done? You are worse off than a man in Swazi jail. He gets a little which he can spend when he comes out, but you will never have a penny." "Yes," answered Rees, "but remember this, I did it by choice." The moment he said that, it seemed as if the whole heavens were illuminated, and the Holy Spirit said to him, "Let me tell you what you have done. Tonight I have grafted you into the vine, and all the sap can flow through you. You are a branch in the Savior. The branch gets nothing. It is the needy that get the fruit. Now, please understand what I'm saying to you today as I read this. You can believe that you are a branch in the vine. That does not make it so. You can believe that you are a Christian and that you are saved. That belief does not make it so. What makes it so is the actual experiencing of the reality of what you claim. You claim to be a branch, but does the sap of God flow through your life, or are you supplied by worldly means? Answer the question faithfully. Are you a branch? Are you a branch that is in Jesus, where the sap flows out as he chooses? Or are you a branch of the world because your nurturance and your support and what you cherish most for entertainment comes from the world? A man said to me, "There's nothing wrong with having my favorite professional sports team." Oh, isn't there? So you're grafted into your sports team. You can't be grafted into Jesus and into your entertainment with the sports team at the same time. You can't be grafted into Jesus and into the world at the same time. Some of you want to go to the lounges and the clubs. You want to go participate in all kinds of worldly events. You can't do that and be grafted into Jesus. If your nurturance and your support is flowing out of the world, if the comfort to your heart flows out of the world, you are grafted into the world. So be honest with me. Are you grafted into Jesus in reality, or as a statement of belief and philosophy? Remember how I opened this broadcast. Jesus is not an idea. He is not a philosophy. He is a man. And if you are not grafted into that man, if he is not the bread you eat and the drink you have to quench your thirst, then you are not grafted into him. You can be in your nicey-nice church. You can have your coffee and donuts, and you can have a wonderful, entertaining social life. You can be inspired just as you can be at the Kennedy Center if you go down to the Opera House. You can cry a little. You can laugh a little. You can have friends who are there. You can. All of that is possible for you. Your church can be your Kennedy Center. It's not Jesus. It's not Jesus. It's time to wake up. America is collapsing. When will you wake up? When will you come to your senses and say, "I must have Jesus"? When will you make that decision? You cannot have the world and Jesus too. It's an oxymoron. You can't have it that way. You either have Jesus and you're part of a church that belongs to Jesus, or you are of the world. Regardless of all your religious inspirational feelings, you're still of the world. Let me continue. Tonight I have grafted you into the vine, and all the sap can flow through you. You are a branch in the Savior. The branch gets nothing. It is the needy that get the fruit. But after tonight, from this place of abiding, whatever the Father wants to pour out to the world through you, he can do so. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. See, this is why I don't come on this broadcast and beg you for money. I know the ones who are grafted into Jesus, and the sap of Jesus is flowing through their lives will hear this honest word of the gospel, and they will send offerings that will pay for this radio broadcast. I know that. I've experienced it month after month after month. The ones who want a book, the ones who want some gift to entice them to send their money, you're not going to be interested in this ministry because we don't have anything to give you except Jesus. That's what we have to give you, Jesus, the cross, to be crucified, to live in Jesus Christ. That's what we have for you. That's all. He went on, the Holy Spirit, because you've done this for me, you're no longer a servant, but I call you a friend. It was a personal revelation of the Savior's words in John 15, and for days, Reese said, the joy and realization of it overcame him. For the next 18 months, he never spent a penny except on necessities, and it was through that period that he had all the sense of ownership of money taken out of him. The real test, as it often is, was on the very fine point and did not come for 4 months. It was a matter of one penny. And as remarked, it shows how keenly the husbandman watches the branch. At the last convention, he'd met a gentleman from London, Mr. John Gossett, of whom we're going to hear more as the book continues. This friend had asked for his address, and then at Christmas sent him two books and a card. The conflict came over the desire to send a New Year's card back to him with a letter of thanks. He said, I naturally wanted to return the compliment. I thought it will only cost me a penny. But the Holy Ghost made plain that what mattered was not the amount, but the principle and the obedience in maintaining the position. A New Year's card was not a necessity of life. So he wrote Mr. Gossett, thanking him for the books, and at the time, giving him the reason for not sending a card. After the letter had been posted, an attack came from the accuser of the brethren. Now you have insulted your friend. You are suggesting that he is misusing his money. However, the young man was able to trust his master that he would not let the enemy convey a false impression which was not intended. 2 weeks later, they were praying for £2 and had to get it on a certain day. That very morning, a letter came from London. It was from Mr. Gossett. And when Rees Howells opened it, the first thing he found was £2 enclosed. The letter ran, received your letter, and the blessing I got through it was of more value to me than all the Christmas and New Year cards put together. Every Sunday, I visit the Westminster Hospital. So last Sunday, your letter was my sermon to the patients, a position gained through grace. Whenever you need money for your work, if you will only let me know, it will be my joy to share in it. And that, of course, Mr. Howells would never do. His needs were to be made known only by way of the throne. But he added, I found it quite easy to reach this gentleman in that way. He became a great friend and was often used by the Lord to answer our prayers. Let me ask you a question. Can you be reached easily by another person or ministry by way of the prayer closet? Or can you only be reached with emotional appeals and with the offering of CDs and books? Tell me, be honest. Do you believe that Jesus is more than an idea? Do you believe that Jesus is more than a philosophy? Is he more than an idea or a philosophy in your heart? Are you a soldier of the cross? Are you a pilgrim on a pilgrim journey? Are you a stranger and an alien in this land? Or have you settled into the wickedness of this world and called yourself a Christian? Be honest. Look at your life. Don't be defensive. Look honestly at your life. Have you made that full surrender to Jesus Christ, including your money? Are you willing to not spend your money on non-essentials that you might have the money for the gospel of Jesus Christ? For those who desperately need your help, not because some pastor offers you something if you'll give something, not because he promises that if you give this, you'll get a 100-fold return and you'll be blessed financially. That's such a crock of foolishness. Don't believe those lying men who speak this way. Have you reached out this week and helped a brother or sister who you know is in need? Can they reach your pocketbook by way of the cross, by way of the prayer closet? Are you in tune with the Holy Spirit? Or are you a flesh, in tune with the flesh, walking in the flesh? In commenting later on this radical dealing of the Spirit of God with him, Mr. Howell said, "I finished with ownership once and for all. I became as dead to money as to the stones on the road. It was a great joy in those days to think that the Savior had made me a branch, a channel through which his resurrection life could flow to the needy world. There is no closer relationship than between a branch and the vine. But one thing the husbandman cannot do is to graft the old life into the vine. Self can never abide in the Savior. You must be cut off from the old life." That had been going on, and there were many stages in my life before this came. Without his new life, all our activity and work in the sight of God is as nothing. Yet the vine cannot do anything without the branch. As the sap of the tree is running through the branch. And when this new life flows through us, every bit of us tingles with it. Even our very body itself. If the vine has joy, the branch has the same joy, and the needy get the fruit. In future years, Reese Howells was to handle the Lord's money by the thousands of pounds. And as he later said, he has never questioned me on anything I spent for such a stewardship, with never again a claim of ownership. The experience of that night and the 18 months obedience which followed formed the essential preparation. Have you undergone that essential preparation for the gospel of Jesus Christ? Or have you tried to ask Jesus to graft your flesh into the vine? Are you sinning and then repenting and then sinning and then repenting and finally saying, "It doesn't matter if I repent, I'm saved, just like I am. I'm in the flesh. I'm sinning against God. I know there are things in my life that God is not pleased with. I know there are things in my life that stand in rebellion against the Most High. But it's okay, I'm grafted into Jesus." No, you're not. You were lied to. You cannot be grafted into Jesus and walk in uncleanness at the same time. It's impossible. the sap of God. The Holy Spirit will not flow through your life if you're walking in rebellion against the Most High. That's as straight as I can say it to you. Do you have ears that can hear? Do you understand that you cannot be in Jesus and in sin at the same time? That Jesus requires a total and complete surrender of our lives, and the power of God then begins to flow in us, circumcising our heart, writing on our hearts the commands of God, so that when we're following our natural